And so I asked the Lord, okay, what do I do here? Would you show me what's attacking him? And I heard Holy Spirit say, go look in the bathroom. Now this sounds crazy, but I went down the hallway. It was a hostel, so it's a shared, you know, bathroom. Went down the hallway and looked in the bathroom stall. And when I opened up, I saw a sadhu priest, which is like a witch doctor, fortune teller there in India. He was sitting on the toilet seat and he had my husband's picture in his hand. And he was doing these weird chants. And I remember I got that righteous anger thing came up in me. And I just said, in the name of Jesus, you can have no power or authority over my family and over my husband. I plead the blood of Christ right now, and you have to go. And just right then, he was gone, like that.
Go look in the bathroom. Hello, Bezel T3. Now, here is the backstory to that most provocative intro.
So my husband and me were actually missionaries for a time in India, and we had a crazy experience. When we first got there, we were staying in a hostel, and he got very, very, very sick. And you know, here I was in India, I don't speak the language, I can't read the signs, and my husband is not able to hold food down for many, many days.
And so Anna was told by the Holy Spirit to flush out an Indian witch doctor in a toilet stall with a picture of her husband, and she pleads the blood of Christ, and poof, he was gone. Just another day in the life of Anna Werner, whose website boasts of her moving in the prophetic as a seer who teaches the supernatural. Anna is being interviewed by Patricia King about her new book, The Warrior Dance. It's based on, you guessed it, visions of Jesus. Warning, this book will cause great spiritual harm to anyone foolish enough to believe its contents. Do not purchase.
In your vision, I mean, you had two visions that inspired you to write the book. Mm-hmm. And the second one was about the Lord giving out dancing slippers.
Yes, I was taken into a vision and I was running towards Jesus in the throne room and I was wearing this bridal gown, but when I looked down, my feet had these really old worn out tennis shoes on, but I was running towards Jesus and he handed me these dancing slippers and he said, no, this is how you do this here. This is how you have victory. Wow. And so I put on these dance slippers and I just started to worship Jesus there in the throne room. And as I worshiped, there's just beautiful colors were released. And it just changed my perspective on how do we do spiritual warfare? Hey, we do it from the place of victory and worship.
Once again, we have a person who belongs to a very special class of Christians who are allowed to enter the very throne room of heaven, who not only receive heavenly dancing booties from Jesus for spiritual warfare, but unlike the Apostle Paul, is able to describe the beautiful colors that were released when she held them. Now, why anyone would need special shoes to do spiritual warfare in the place where God dwells is beyond me. Now, rather than linger, remember that word, here with Anna and Patricia, I found another video where Anna's visions are even more fanciful. Here she is on Sid Roth's buddy, Ryan Bruss's show, Something More. Anna is describing her recent encounter with the glorified, risen Savior in heaven.
So, it was when I was in Israel. I was doing the Sid Roth tour this past fall, and I was there, and I was meeting with a prophetic lady. Sometimes as a seer, I don't always see it right away. You right. know, I feel his presence. So all you feelers out there, that's for you.
Now, our collective discernment feelers should be standing straight up right about now. And just to be clear, Anna is claiming an office that was given to very few people in the Bible. Jeremiah, among other biblical writers, was a prophet and seer in the Old Testament. We find this in Jeremiah 1, 11 and 12. The word of the Lord came to me saying, what do you see, Jeremiah? And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then the Lord said to me, you have seen well, for I am watching over my word to perform it. And in the New Testament, Paul, Stephen, and John, although never called seers, also had true visions of heaven. Now, like most other modern-day false prophets, fire is a big deal. So let's see how many times Anna refers to fire.
And then I had my arms like this because I was like, assume the position, I'm going to worship Jesus, right? And then I could see fire going between my hands. Now, this fire between my hands became a wall of fire.
Wow.
Now, sometimes we think of fire and we think of hell, right? But actually, when you're in the glory, there's fire.
Holy fire.
It's holy fire.
Right.
It is holy fire. And so I was in this wall of fire, and I heard Holy Spirit say, stick your head through it. Now, this sounds a little odd. That's okay. I'm a seer, so I'm not going to hold back who I am. So he said, stick your head through this wall that you're seeing. Mm. So I put my head through like this. And when I looked through on the other side, I was face to face with Jesus.
Wow.
When you're in the glory, there's fire. We're being asked to swallow hook, line, and sinker that Anna saw holy fire, stuck her head through it, and saw Jesus face to face. It's worth noting that not one of the New Testament writers say anything even remotely close to what Anna is claiming here. Anna would do well to read Hebrews 12, 18 through 21, where the author recounts the terror of God descending on Mount Sinai. He writes, "For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom, and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose word made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given, that if even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear." But then verse 22 shifts to the wonder of the new covenant. "But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel." And then a little further, beginning at verse 28, we read, "Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire." Now that phrase harkens back to Hebrews 10:27. "But a terrifying expectation of the judgment and the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries." To speak about casually waltzing into heaven and seeing Jesus, the King of Glory, face to face is a very dangerous thing. Anna will now describe the eyes of the Lord Jesus as she stares right at him.
They're so alive. There's fire in those eyes. Mm. You look at them and you feel, you see the fire, but not only do you see fire, but the fire goes through you.
Wow.
And so I am looking at him like I'm looking at you, but I'm eye to eye with him. And I can feel the fire of God consuming me.
I feel it now.
It burns through you.
Ryan says that he feels it now. That's very odd, because Scripture tells us in Revelation 22 that the throne of God and of the Lamb will be within the city, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. This is describing the renewed earth after the final consummation of all things. You see, Anna is not yet glorified and still sinful, so gazing upon the eyes of the risen and glorified Lord would only do one thing, totally destroy her. As God said to Moses in Exodus 33:20, "You cannot see my face, for no one can see me and live."
See, he's accessible. He is so accessible. And often our unbelief that we can have access is what hinders us from getting there. But he is just a papa daddy. And he allows us, he invites us to come sit right up on his lap.
Now, wait a minute. Jesus is a papa daddy? He invites us to sit on his lap? What happened to the fundamental Christian doctrine of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Now listen carefully to what Anna says next.
How do you personally cultivate your walk with God to receive more and more and more? Every time I see you, you're receiving more of God.
Right.
How do we do that?
You know, that's a good question. I think that for me, what I've learned, now, obviously there's things that help us. We get reading the word, we spend time praying. It says, enter his gates through thanksgiving and praise. Yeah. So those are all keys.
Now that's a pretty low view of scripture and flies right in the face of 1 Timothy 3:16 that declares that all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction and training in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be complete, equipped for every good work, no lingering required.
Right.
But for me, the biggest thing is learning to linger.
Do you have to let it linger? Do you have to? Do you have to? Do you have to let it linger?
In his presence. Like, I believe that Jesus whispers his secrets to those that are willing to just rest their head on his chest.
There are so many glaring problems with what she just said. Now let's start going backwards. Resting one's head on his chest? Well, but you just said we're to sit on his lap, so which is it? And Jesus whispers his secrets to us as we linger? Anna is suggesting that Jesus gives her special nuggets of new revelation as she lingers with him. She says reading God's word and prayer, well, they're important keys to get more of God. But the biggest thing is learning to linger. And as far as God's secret things go, well, Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things belong to the Lord our God. But the things that are revealed belong to us and our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law.
What are you feeling? What are you seeing right now?
I just see the fire falling. Listen, you at home, I just want to say something to you. Maybe you're watching this and you think this is just for you or the elite, but it is not. The fire of God is falling on you right now. I can feel it getting thicker here in the studio. Fire. I just pray for the fire of God to fall over you right now. You're going to start feeling the tangible presence of God that we're all feeling in this studio right now. It is heat. There's heat and warmth. Mm. Some of you are feeling...
I'm sorry. What she just said made me think of a song from way back when.
Like, it almost feels like a tangible or tingling going through your body. And what you're tapping into is the glory realm.
Wow. You know, I wish it were true. I wish it were that simple. I really do. Just believe in the fire of God will come upon you and in all its thickness and heal you of whatever you are dealing with. But that's simply not so, folks. Now, it's true that we are promised that by his stripes we are healed, Isaiah 53.
In the glory, there's healing. It's totally accessible for you. You can grab onto it, whatever your miracle is that you're needing right now. God is healing you. By his stripes, you've been healed. I just declare over you right now.
But the stripes that Jesus took upon himself, that Christians will be completely healed because of, well, that comes on the final day, that final judgment day at the return of Jesus Christ when he returns. And the dead in Christ are raised to be reunited with their glorified souls. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, what is sown or buried is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. But in this present age, Paul tells us that we are always to be of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Friends, let's not be fooled by these theology of glory junkies. They want nothing to do with the words of Scripture found in Romans 8, 16 through 18. And I'll end with this. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us when Jesus returns.